Today we are going to see basic concepts of geomorphology. This is also known as the fundamental concepts of geomorphology. So let's see what are the fundamental concepts of geomorphology. This person, that is William David Thornbury, this person over here, he has given most of these fundamental concepts. In total, we studied 10 important concepts and he has given most of this. So what do we mean by fundamental concepts? So these concepts are used to interpret the landscapes. We know geomorphology has to do with landscape studies. So these concepts helps the geomorphologists to understand, to interpret the various landscapes. And this person Thornbury, in his book, Principles of Geomorphology, he had underlined these concepts. So the first concept, as you are seeing here, it says that the same physical processes and laws that operate today operated throughout the geologic time, although not necessarily always with the same intensity as of now. So this means that the physical processes that operate, that we see today, it is nothing new. It has been operating throughout geological time. Geological time means throughout history, it has been operating. But of course, the intensity or the way in which, or the degree in which it has been operating may be not the same. Now let us understand what is this. Now what do we mean by physical processes? When we speak of physical processes, that means there are various physical processes. Most of you are aware of that. That is the fluvial process or aeolian process or glacial process, the various processes of mass wasting, weathering, etc. So these are the various physical processes, the various processes of diastrophism, etc. So these physical processes has been operating. That is, for example, glacial. You are seeing over here, there are two pictures which is showing some glacial landforms. So this is of recent landforms. And this is around 10,000 years ago during the Pleistocene Ice Age. So even today we find glacial landform. 10,000 years also ago, we used to find glacial landform. So that is not new. But then around 10,000 years ago, it was called the Ice Age. Because it was Ice Age, so the intensity of the glacial landforms, intensity of fluvial landforms, the intensity of glacial landform, intensity of glacial process was much more because that was the time of the Ice Age. So because it was Ice Age, more and more of the earth was covered with ice. And that is why, quite obviously, because it was covered with ice, so obviously the intensity of the various erosion owing to ice was much more than it is today, because now we don't have Ice Age. So the same kinds of features, if we had drumlins as a glacial feature, we did not have a karst topography as a glacial feature. Whatever was the glacial features was present here 10,000 years ago. Same is present here. But the intensity of the glacial erosion was much more during that time. So this thing, that what was same today, what is same today, was also same previously. This concept is called the principle of uniformitarianism. Uniformitarianism. So that means, just like I said, that whatever is today was before. For example, the karst topography that we see today, it was the same even before. So, but then what is this uniformitarianism? First, let me say that this person, Hutton, in 1785, he proposed this principle and it was popularized by this person. Now, it means the assumption that the same natural laws, so the natural laws are all these, the same natural laws or the natural laws are these, the same natural laws and processes that operate today in our present day, that same thing has been operating, it operated in the universe in the past as well. And it can be applied everywhere in the universe. So this is the meaning of uniformitarianism. That is, it was uniform. What is now was before. And that is why Hutton said that present is the key to the past. If we see the present, we can have an idea of what was in the past, because it was the same principle, uniformitarianism. It was the same. Hutton saw this particular area. This is a place, it's called the Sikar Point. So over here, as you can see, that there are this horizontal red sandstone. This horizontal red sandstone above these vertically tilted rocks. So he found same kinds of feature elsewhere in some other port, in some other bay, and around quite a couple of years back. So seeing that, he understood that this kind of features, since this is found, he found these kinds of features in multiple areas. So he proposed this principle that it is the same laws are operating everywhere. If you see this picture over here, what it says, these are the mountains. Now, because of various erosional materials, these mountains gets eroded. Once it is eroded over here, it is getting deposited. Once it is getting deposited, slowly it is forming rocks. Then the rocks, because of various reasons, because of erosion, etc., these rocks goes underground, under the earth's surface. Maybe they get covered with other rock surfaces. So they, now after this lithification, what happens? This enters the earth's crust, this enters and then the mantle. Then what happens? It gets converted to magma. The magma again comes out in the form of volcanoes. And then they again solidifies into mountains. And again, this process goes on repeatedly. So this is the physical processes. So the same physical processes that we find today, just like I had told you, fluvial, etc., aeolian, etc., has been operating throughout geological history, but maybe not in the same intensity. It depends upon various other factors, maybe the climate, etc. Now let's come to concept number two. What does it say? It says a geological structure is a dominant controlling factor in the evolution of landforms, and it is reflected in them. Now, what do we mean by this? What do we mean by geological structure? Most importantly, what is a geological structure? Now, the term structure can be what that is, what kind of rock that is, what type of rock, what are the various attributes of that rock. Here, the various attributes of the rock, the porosity, the permeability of the rock, or what kind of nature of hardness that is. So whether that is igneous rock, that is sedimentary rock, that is metamorphic rock, etc. So what kind of rock? So what kind of rock that is? That by that we mean the geological structure. So it also includes all the various ways in which the earth's materials, out of which the landforms are carved. So they differ from one another. So every kind over here, supposing these igneous rocks, so they differ from one another in their physical and chemical attributes. So every rock is different because the minerals that the rock is, the rocks are formed of minerals. So this, the characteristics of these minerals are different. So it is a common practice, like over here you are seeing, this is shale. Shale is a weak rock. So since it is a weak rock, so it has formed low valleys. It has been more eroded. See, it has been more eroded. but these igneous rocks are pretty hard rocks, so they did not get eroded much. They are resistant to erosion, so they have become mountains. They are rising atop this shale limestone. The chemical composition of limestone is such that they will get eroded in water, rainwater, very easily by forming carbonic acid. So each and every, this is the structure, geological structure. So generally it is a common practice that rocks which are hard or resistant or weak or non-resistant, these types of rocks will differ differently with the various geomorphic processes. So the rocks will be attacked differently. The various rocks with various kinds of structures will differ accordingly by both physical or chemical processes. So it is very much obvious that is a rock that is resistant, like over here, it is resistant to one process, it may not be resistant to another process. So like this rock limestone over here is resistant, it is not resistant to water, but igneous is resistant to water. So it is not necessarily that all are resistant to same kinds of thing. So a rock may be resistant to one process, but it may be non-resistant to another under various kinds of climate. So generally it is seen that the specific geological structure is result of a specific topographic feature. So specific geological structures like folded, like faulted, like horizontal, domal or vertical will have their own type of topography. So a folded topography won't be the same as a horizontal. This is a folded topography. So this won't be same to, this folded won't be same to a domal topography. A domal won't be same to a horizontal topography. A horizontal won't be same to a vertical topography. A vertical topography won't be same to a faulted topography. So we are seeing that various kinds of rock structures, these are all structures, they are having their own types of lithology. They are having their own types of landforms. Now let us come to the third concept. To a large degree, the Earth's surface possesses relief because the geomorphic processes operate at different rates. Now, the various geomorphic processes, I have told you what are the various geomorphic processes. So all the geomorphic processes, they do not operate in the same rate. Why they do not operate in the same rate? Because the rocks, the various kinds of rocks, which is there in the Earth's crust, they vary in the lithology and structure that I have told in the previous slide. They vary in the lithology and structure. Because they have got different kinds of structure, because they have different kinds of composition or lithology, so that is why, because they vary in the lithology and structure, so they offer various degrees of resistance to the various erosion process. Like over here, you are seeing a karst topography. They are not resistant to water, rainfall. So they have formed sinkholes like this. This is an example of karst topography. So they have formed sinkholes like this. So generally the areas which are topographically high, that is they are quite high land, they will have hard rock. Like for example, this slide that you are seeing over here. See over here, this rock over here, this rock over here, this layer over here, this you can see it has not been much eroded. But if you are seeing this particular layer over here, this particular layer over here, or this layer over here, you see that it has been eroded back much more than this. So that means in a single area, this is a single place, a single area, within a single area you are seeing, so this is a micro topography. So within a single area you are seeing different degree of relief. So over here the relief is much more, over here the relief is much less. So this is called a microtopography. Why? Because we are seeing over here difference of the rock nature or composition or structure in a local topography. This local topography, when we study local topography, that is called microtopography. So this is called a microtopography. So what we are seeing over here, that's in certain areas where the topography is high, that is underlain by hard rock. This is a hard rock. But where it is low, it is a soft rock. Take the example of this picture over here. Over here, you are seeing this upper layer. It is extremely hard rock. So you see it has not much been eroded. Then we find hard rock. It has been eroded, but then there are various, it is jutting out. It is coming out. Then this place is extremely weak rock. So it has got eroded back much more. So within a particular area, we are seeing various degrees of relief. So this is what has been said: to a large degree, the Earth's surface possesses relief because the various geomorphic processes operate at different rate. Over here, the rate is much more than here, because of why? Because of the nature of lithology and the nature of structure. Let's come to the fourth one. So what does the fourth concept says? Geomorphic processes leave their distinct imprint upon landforms, and each geomorphic process develops its own characteristic assemblage of landforms. Now, this means what? That every geomorphic process, I have told you about the processes, they have their own types of landforms. They each will have their own types of landforms, so own assemblage of landforms. Now take the example of plants and animals. Now if we say plants, then a plant is a general term. But then we know what plant is what. We can identify a mango plant from maybe a pine tree. We easily know that this is a pine tree and this is a mango tree. Why? Because they have their distinct imprint. A mango tree will have its own imprint and a pine tree will have its own imprint. Similarly, animal kingdom. We know that which is what animal. So that means each and every species have their own diagnostic characteristics. Similarly, landforms will also have their distinguishing features, due to which we know, okay, this kind of landform is the result of this process and that kind of landform is a result of that process. For example, let us take the example of floodplains or alluvial plains or deltas. So we know that these are the products of what? Of these. That is the fluvial process or the stream action. We know that the sinkholes, the caverns are due to the groundwater. The moraines, etc., are drumlins, are owing to this glacial processes. Or for that matter, the various inselbergs, etc., are aeolian processes. So we know that what is what? What is due to what? So we know that the landforms, they are not just haphazardly developed. They are developed because of the various processes that works on them. So what are the various processes? These various processes can be divided into endogenic and exogenic processes. So these are the various processes on which the landforms they are dependent upon. Now let's come to the concept number 5, that is what, as the different erosional agencies act upon the Earth's surface, there is produced a sequence of landforms having distinctive characteristics at the successive stages of the development. Now when we speak about this, so that means we are speaking about geomorphic cycle. There is a cycle of development. Like the youthful level, then comes the mature level, then comes the old level. So generally it was David who first spoke about this cycle of development. So landform is controlled by structure, process and stage. But many a times this particular concept, the concept of this successful stages, many a times many geomorphologists, they are not favoring this cycle. They are not favoring this concept of cycle or concept of stage. They have used various other terminologies, like Penck has used entwickelung, etc. So various other terminologies has been used. But then whatever may be the fact, whether or not this concept of cycle or stage has been used or not, but it is a fact that geology, structure and climate, they will obviously have, because of them, a sequence of landform is developed. So you can, that sequence can be termed as stage, that sequence can be termed as cycle, that sequence can be termed as entwicklung, etc. And it is, there should be no confusion to the fact that a geomorphic cycle is the period of time that is required for the reduction of an area to base level. It is not that any area directly comes to a base level. So for an area, for an uplifted area to come to a base level, various erosional agencies will act upon it. Like over here, you are seeing the fluvial agencies. So various erosional agencies will act upon an area, will act upon a landform to erode that landform. And slowly, as it is eroded, what happens? It will get eroded into a sequence of landform. It will follow a sequence. It is not that from directly here to here. It will follow a sequence. Now we can term that sequence into various terminologies, as David has used, youth, maturity, and old. Now let us come to concept number 6. What it says, complexity is more than the simplicity in geomorphic evolution. So it is more easy to find complex landforms than simple landforms. So it is very rare to find a landscape that is influenced by a single geomorphic process. Now what this is? See, it is our human nature to prefer a simple explanation to everything. But many a times, we do not have a simple explanation, or many a times the simple explanation may not be the correct explanation. And as is written over here, it is very rare to find landscape which is a result of a single geomorphic process. So, like for example, this particular place, no one can say that only a single geomorphic process, that means, for example, only aeolian process has, this is the result of only aeolian process, or this is the result of only coastal erosion. So it doesn't happen that way. Generally, what we see that more than one geomorphic features acts in that area. So maybe not only fluvial, but maybe some other geomorphic feature will act in that area. So maybe that area is a result of volcano, that area has seen earthquakes also. So it is not that only one geomorphic process has operated in that, only one earthquake or only one geomorphic cycle, etc. So generally what happens in an area, in any area, that area is generally a result of more than one geomorphic process. So Horberg, a person with the name of Horberg, in 1952, he had come out with these 5 kinds of landforms. He had said that landforms can be divided into these 5 types: simple, compound, monocyclic, multicyclic, and exome. So what is a simple landform? Means there is only one energy and one erosional cycle. Erosional cycle means youth, maturity, and old. You will learn more about this erosional cycle in the cycle of erosion, in the lecture of cycle of erosion. So only one energy means maybe only one fluvial process, maybe one Aeolian process, maybe only glacial process, etc. So only one energy and one erosional cycle. One erosional cycle, just like I said, youth, maturity, and old. That is a simple landform. Then comes compound landforms. Compound means more than one energy. That is maybe water energy and glacial energy. Then we have monocyclic, only one erosional cycle. Multicyclic, more than one erosional cycle. How more than one erosional cycle? So maybe youth, maturity, old. After it has become old, then again that place has been uplifted. Because of upliftment, what happens? Again, after coming to base level, like for example over here, it has, see the width over here and see the width over here. So it has been eroded to old, and after it has come eroded to old, then what happens? It becomes uplifted, again it becomes uplifted, and then again this cycle continues. That is called a multicyclic, when more than one erosional cycle is operating. And what do you mean by exhumed? Exhumed means that, like for example, this is an exhumed land surface. So maybe this land surface was buried. It was buried under, beneath some younger rocks. But because that younger rocks gets eroded away, so when it gets eroded away or when it gets removed, then what this older landform, this gets exposed. So this is called exhumed or resurrected landform. So this is resulted due to what? Due to denudational process, due to denudation. Or this may also occur because of multicyclic. Maybe because of erosion, the above younger rocks has been removed, or maybe this whole structure has been uplifted. So exhumed. So generally we find from 2 to 5. We generally find from 2 to 5. So it is more complex. We find more complex than a simple landform which is rarely existent. Now see this. This is an example of a polycyclic landform. And this is an example of an exhumed landform. Now this river channel that you are seeing over here, this river channel, this was buried, but because of the removal of the above layer, this river channel was again seen. It was again seen. So this is an exhumed landform because this river channel, which was earlier buried, was the above cover was removed and this got exhumed or resurrected. So once this is done, then what will happen? Again over here, erosion will start. So this is what was meant by exhumed or complexity. So much of the Earth's landform is more complex than simple. So according to concept 7, little of the Earth topography is older than tertiary and most of it no older than Pleistocene. So this term tertiary, this term Pleistocene, these are all what epoch. These are all periods in geological history, geological time scale. So over here you find the geological time scale. So what it says, the little of the Earth is older than tertiary. Most of the Earth is not, Earth's landform is not older than tertiary, this period. But most of it, maximum part, is not older than this Pleistocene. Over here you see the million of years ago. So more, little of the Earth's topography is older than 66.4 million years ago. But most of it actually is not older than 1.6 million years ago. Now why this is so? This is so because such topography that is around this much, 144, 208, etc. So ancient topography are rare. And even if they, why they are rare? Because they have been eroded out. And supposing they have not been eroded out, so what has happened to them? Just like what I have told you about the various exhumed, about the exhumed landforms, etc. So most of them are not older than this Pleistocene, because such ancient topography are rare, and even if they do exist, they are existing in what? In exhumed forms. That is, upon them, younger alluvium, younger deposition has occurred. And in such a way, they have been covered. Those older landforms has been covered. And maximum of them, they have been degraded, because it is a huge time scale, as you are seeing over here. 144 million years ago, a landform to stay intact through 144 million years ago, it is very rare. So most of them have been degraded in the geological time. And as we take, and according to Ashley, he believed that most of the geomorphic landforms, they were formed after the Miocene, that is during this. Of what of the present day landforms, they have been formed after the Miocene. And if we look at the Himalayas range, the Himalayan range, then this Himalayan range, they were first folded during the, we know that Himalaya is a folded mountain range. Now they were first folded during this time, that is Cretaceous. And later on, this in the Eocene and Miocene age, they were much more folded. But their present elevation, we know that the Himalayas are a young fold mountain, and still it is being uplifted, it is elevated. So their present elevation is occurred during this Pliocene area. And most of the topographical details we find during this Pleistocene age. So accordingly, 90% of the landforms are during this tertiary and before this Pleistocene era. Okay, now let us see concept 8. What is concept 8? It says that proper interpretation of present day landscapes is impossible without a full appreciation of the manifold influences of the geologic and climatic changes during the Pleistocene. Now, just before this concept, we had seen this concept that most of the Earth's topography is of the Pleistocene era. Since it is of Pleistocene era, so to understand the various topography, we must do what? We have to understand what was the geological condition during this Pleistocene? What was the climatic condition during the Pleistocene? Once we understand the geologic condition of the Pleistocene, once we understand the climatic condition of the Pleistocene, then only we will be able to understand, we will able to interpret the present day landscapes. Why? The reason has been given in concept 7, because most of the landscape is of this era, of this Pleistocene era. Now, if you see over here, geology and climate changes during the Pleistocene era, they have far-reaching effects upon our present-day topography. What is the reason? Now, before coming to the reason, here are two important things. One is geology and one is climate. So the idea of the geology and the climate change during the Pleistocene is important. Why? Because during this Pleistocene era, we had the ice age. We had not only about ice age, we had glacial outwash and wind-blown materials of glacial origin. They extended all over the world. Now, if you see this, what is written that during that time, the glaciers, the continental glaciers were till the 40th parallel. So till the 40th latitude, 40 degree north, it extended to 40 degree north, and 30% of the Earth's surface was covered by ice. So you can see over here, these white patches, this indicates that these areas were all covered with ice. So we had even Moscow, present day Moscow, and parts of the other parts of Mongolia, etc., even Chicago, if you see the map over here, even Chicago was the area of Chicago, New York, etc. All these were what? They were covered with ice. So how much was the ice cover? This was the ice cover in Asia and even extending to Africa. So that is why it is very much essential to understand the Pleistocene climate, because if we had ice cover, if we had glacier cover extending to 48th parallel, then that means we would have much more features of glacial landforms in those areas. So here this represents two pictures of the Earth, which was modern day picture. This is the modern day picture. We have continental ice only in this part. This is a Greenland area. And this is the picture what we had 18,000 years before, during the Pleistocene era. So over here you see the ice cover, not only Greenland over here, but all these parts were covered with ice. Since all these parts were covered with ice, it is very much natural that there was glacial landform in all these parts, and glacial landform or landform affected by glacial erosion, we will find features of that in these areas. So supposing if we find right now features of glacial landform in this area, maybe Chicago area, we might find it very hard to believe that how in Chicago is there glacial landform. So for this, we need to understand the history of the geological time, the history of these landforms. So we need to know the history of the Pleistocene. The history of Pleistocene says that there was ice cover in this place. Since there was ice cover, so the geology was affected by the climatic condition during that time. So it is very much essential to know about that. So over here, this is a picture of a glacial landform. So you find glacial landform over here. So the glacial landform, just like I have said in one of the concepts, that each and every feature process will have its distinct imprint on the landform. So that a glacial process will have a distinct type of landform. So if we find this distinct type of landform in a present day dry area, for example, Africa, it might be quite hard to believe. So to believe that, we need to understand, we need to know about the Pleistocene age. What was in the Pleistocene age? So in the Pleistocene age, this is what was there. It extended well into Africa. Since it extended well into Africa, so we will know that, okay, so we can find various forms of glacial features in present day tropical areas. Now, concept number 9, what it says, that is that appreciation, or we must know, of the world climates is necessary, and appreciation of the world climates is necessary to a proper understanding of the varying importance of the different geomorphic processes. So this means that we must know of the world climates, and an understanding of the world climates is very much necessary, is very much important to know about the various types of geomorphic processes. Now, there are certain climates, like you are seeing over here, the various climates of the world. Now, we must understand that it is not possible for us in a semi-arid region to have glacial kind of geomorphic process. Or for that matter, we must understand that in a glacial area, we can't have what we have in a tropical belt. So we must understand about the various climates, about the world climates, because climatic variation, they will affect what kind of geomorphic process, either directly or indirectly. So for example, in certain areas where we will have a more of ice, a preponderance of ice, but in or low temperature. So in those areas, weathering or erosion which is affected by ice or low temperature will be much more than regions in these areas where aeolian landform will be much more prevalent. So we will have to understand the world climates, what is where. So based upon that, we know that these are the various types of geomorphic processes that is prevalent according to world climates. So in desert geomorphology, we know that this kind of geomorphic process will be possible, or desert geomorphology is the geomorphology of a desert climate. Periglacial is the geomorphology of a periglacial climate, and tropical that of a tropical area. So we won't find a desert thing, desert geomorphology, aspects of desert geomorphology in a tropical area. For example, this is called an atoll. Atolls are found in Pacific Ocean. These are formed of corals. Atolls are formed of corals, coral polyps, corals. In Australia, we can find maximum of this in Australia. So these are the features of landforms, features of tropical climate. You won't find atolls in outside the tropics. This is a mushroom rock. So you won't find a mushroom rock in a glacial climate. This is a feature of a glacial landform. So this you won't find outside the glaciers. So we have to understand the varying degree of climates in the various areas to know about the various landforms in those things. And the last concept is geomorphology, although concerned primarily with present day landscape, attains its maximum usefulness by historical extension. Now over here, this again, if we look at this, this means we can again come back to the first concept that we had studied about the uniformitarianism. Now, uniformitarian's concept again is over here. How? Because it says clearly that when we study geomorphology of the present day, we have to study about the what it was in the historical past, what it was previously. So that means geomorphology that is present is the key to the past. So herein we come to concept number one, which was the concept of principle of uniformitarianism. So present, since present is the key to the past, so to understand the present, to understand geomorphology of the present day, we must understand what it was in the historical time frame. So, for example, take this diagram over here. So, for example, at first in stage A, it was a mountain over here. This is a study area, our study area. It was a mountain. Later on, what happened, because of various types of erosional processes, so this area got what this area, there was various kinds of erosion, and because of erosion, what has happened, this the various monad knocks appeared. Now because of the various monad knocks has appeared, that means it has got eroded down. Further we see that not only it has eroded down, this monad knocks has also eroded through time, and this sea has also extended inward. Over here, we see that there is no presence of that area. The sea has totally overtaken this land. So if we have to study this particular place, maybe this is submerged somewhere in the sea, we need to study about its historical past. And in the historical past, we will see that somewhere this particular place was actually a mountain. So just like the Himalayas, if we have to study the Himalayas, we have to go to its base. What it is base? That it was a place of the Tethys Sea. So that is the place of Himalayas right now. So how we will study this? How do we study the geomorphology? We can't go back in time. But what we can do is that we can study paleogeomorphology. What is paleogeomorphology? It is a science of the buried relief feature of the earth. When we study about the buried relief feature of the earth, that is called paleogeomorphology. Now, geomorphology, though it concerns with the present landscape, but it always has a linkage with the past geological period. So, since it has linkage with the past geological period, since it is a chain-wise event, so we have to understand about the history of that region. There are other ways how we do that. It is through the various fossils and dendrochronology. So, with various fossils and through what? Maybe because through this knowing about the ice age, dendrochronology is what? By studying the barks, tree barks, like for example, over here, this was formed in 1527. This particular ring, part of that tree was formed in 1650, like this. So tree barks are also gives us input, gives us insights upon the geomorphology of that area. Now, if we see over here, this is a picture of a microtopography. Within a single place, we have ash layer, maybe because of volcanic layer. We also have mudstone. We also have sandstone. So we need to know that maybe in certain times of history, there were features of volcano in this area. So when we have volcano, that means there must be igneous rocks over here. There is also sandstone and we also have mudstone. So during various geological epochs, a geological period, we had different things. So to understand this whole thing, whole landform or the geomorphology of this landform, of the present day landform, we have to understand its past. And we can understand through these various things that I have said just now. So this is about the fundamental concepts of geomorphology.